Hey everyone, Val Evans here, and tonight I've got a special guest, Ernst Wilhelm. Welcome, Ernst.
Hi, Val. Thanks for inviting me. Looking forward to doing this with you.
Yeah, it's great that you're available. I know you're super busy, and now are you doing your YouTube programs regularly now, or?
Not really. I don't do a whole lot on YouTube. I most of my stuff is on my own websites. I've got probably have like 1,300 hours of instruction on astrology and card reading on my two websites. But on YouTube, I guess I have maybe 200 videos now. That's just kind of collected over the years. But I just do a video when I feel like it for YouTube. Like if there's something I'm thinking of that I think would be helpful, or if I have some interesting videos from one of my courses that I think would kind of be helpful for the general people. Mostly though, I teach really involved in-depth courses that are more for people who really want to focus on learning about themselves in a really deep way. And I feel like YouTube isn't necessarily the ideal platform for that. So I do it on my own sites and YouTube just here and there. I think really that I don't really think Vedic is any more difficult or less difficult than Western. It just depends how deep a person wants to go. You know, you can go superficial or deep with any system of astrology you want. And they really share the same roots, Vedic and Western astrology. So it's just the way I teach is very involved, very deep. You know, it's something they really get immersed in. And I don't do little 10 minute here, 10 minute there, fun thing, find one thing. If I'm going to tell you how to find one thing, I'm going to teach you everything in the context of that. So that's just my teaching style.
And if there's a course that somebody wants to try out and goes to your site, what would you suggest should be their first lesson?
You know, what I would say, if a person has like the basics and they know what an aspect is and they know what signs are and they know what planet is exalted in a sign, those very basic things, if they know those few things, I would tell them to take my Lajjitaadi Avasthas master's course.
Okay.
That sounds like a really seriously scary course. I mean, Lajjitaadi, what? Masters? No, I'm going to stay away from that. But the reality is, I call that master's course because it's really about mastering yourself and all your inner life and all your inner problems. And so it's a really good self-help course. It's about 100 videos.
Really?
Wow. It's a serious course, and it covers every possible relationship between the planets that can happen.
Okay.
And in a way that, you know, Lajjitaadi Avasthas are not something, it's simply, Lajjitaadi simply means the ashamed and other conditions. So a planet can be ashamed or starved or other things. There's a certain things, keywords we use. And it really explains how we're using the planet in our lives, but also how our psychological behavior is evolving around that planet. Mm-hmm. And it's just the best course I've come across for helping us work through our issues and problems. And people, when I first started teaching the Lajjitaadi Avasthas, maybe 10 years ago, people were saying, this is the missing link in astrology. This is what we've always been looking for. And this is people who've been studying 30, 40 years, like 70-year-old people have been studying their whole lives.
That's great.
Really, really important. Super simple, though. It's not a lot to learn. That's the beauty of it. And then so that's one I recommend.
I remember you were one of the first astrologers that I started listening to on YouTube, and then KRS Channel 2. And I remember I got a report from him, and I got the report and I was so fascinated, but there was just so much I didn't understand. And some of it was scary because it refers back to, you know, the old days of if you're going to be hung, or, you know, I can't think of an example, but you look at the report and you're like, oh my God. But then you start to understand it through the years and it's not as bad, but still, you know, when you look at a report, sometimes you want to dig down a little bit deeper. So this sounds like a good Christmas present for myself. That's what I'm going to do.
And I have an audio or video. And it's 100 videos. It's probably 60, 70 hours. People cry during it. People change their lives during it.
Wow.
I think it's $108.
Oh, that's
for like $1.25 an hour or something. It's a really great bargain to change your life.
Okay.
And if I was going to do a reading on a person with that technique, I would see them 7 sessions, an hour each session for each of the planets. So it's really deep stuff. So it's a great course.
And do you do personal readings now, or you're
Well, right
focused
now
on?
I'm just too overwhelmed with too much stuff to do them. I have done a lot. Just right now with everything that's been happening in my life the last 2 years, I just have to take a break and catch up on some other things.
Makes sense.
Yeah, it's been like a crazy 2 years.
I know. It's interesting because I read somewhere, and this applies to astrologers from, the medieval era, but the people who become astrologers are the ones who have time to be astrologers. You don't see those people who've got, successful lives at some point in their lives unless they have help. And I know there were a few astrologers of history when they were, I guess, hermits. And really, that's what a lot of people are doing right now. They're inside, they've got time on their hands for self-improvement, and they're
Yeah,
applying it
definitely.
to astrology. So,
Yeah, it's a great time for people to get involved because a lot of people have more time. And during COVID, of course, I think most astrologers saw a big, it was a big boom. I had a lot more people sign up for classes. People had more time. A lot of people who've been too busy came back after a couple of years. So that was really good.
well, that's good. Well, I just want to touch on the eclipse. I saw your show on the eclipse, and it was so interesting. And one of the things that you said was, when you were explaining the lunar eclipse, was that it's the theme is kind of like, you didn't really think you were going to get away with that, did you? If I recall, that's what you
Yeah.
said.
So with that, what's going on with that eclipse, which is the upcoming one on the 8th here, on the 8th, yeah, on the 8th, is that we've got Saturn, Sun, Moon all on tight angles or squares from each other. Okay. And that in the old books from India is called an idiot yoga. Okay. It basically says it's supposed to make somebody an idiot. Now, what an idiot is someone who touches something when they shouldn't. That's basically what it is. And there's definitely a time to push and make something happen. And then there's times keep your hands off. And if you get involved, usually things just get more mucked up. And when these come up as an eclipse, it does show that as the world tries to solve its problems, they're usually not going to be done successfully. They're usually
Makes
just going to
sense.
get more, the problems usually is going to increase. So it's time to just let off and let time take care of things. It can be a tough yoga for a lot of people, but the main thing I think to remember about this yoga, and I kind of made a lot of fun of it in that video calling it the idiot yoga, idiot eclipse and so on, is that lots of times and lots of us, I'm getting hit by this eclipse like really strongly. We're going to do dumb things because of this eclipse, it's just what we're going to do because by its nature, it's going to do that. But again, everything is just a step in the process. And yeah, we might do something stupid, but that's just to set us up for the next big event. And I really see life as life really puts in front of us what we need to get us down the road. And that means being an idiot and doing something that's like, oops, or trying to fix something and breaking it. That can lead to a lot of realizations. And so I really don't see it as a negative thing. But it is definitely a time when it's better to be hands off because the whole nature of Saturn is don't touch it. You're not supposed to touch it. Leave it alone, go to sleep. Saturn is described as being dumb, lazy, lame, and someone who doesn't have anything useful to say, which basically is says don't do anything. Saturn's a planet that's not in a place to do anything. And there is times where nothing we say is going to help, nothing we do is going to help, or we just need to go to bed.
Yes.
And when we wake up, it's better.
It's
And
funny that
what's
you
that?
say
Oh.
that. I not regularly, but occasionally will get some communication from former clients who are just at the end of their rope, or even just friends. And I will tell them that you have said that just when you just can't take it anymore. You're just at the end of your rope. Ernst says, go to sleep. And it sometimes people will say that, you know, well, people will have different opinions about that. But I do think that it's almost letting energy pass. Is that a right way to think about it?
That's one way to look at it. Yogananda, you know, talked about that. He basically said, you know, when things are really bad, just go to sleep. When you wake up in the morning, you'll have a better perspective and things will feel better. Exactly. And a lot of it is just getting that different perspective, waking up with a new day, a new perspective. There's just a time to take a break. And that's what we forget. You know, we have these seven sacred planets and they all have a responsibility. Saturn's responsibility is to tell us when to take a break. It's time to take a break when the things we say don't matter, when we're so hurt, we're lame that we can't get the job done properly, when we're so tired and confused that we can't think straight. You know, these are all Saturn qualities that are telling us, hey, it's time to take a break.
Yeah, when we're stuck.
And if we don't, we just muck things up. And so with this eclipse going on, the sun and moon are there on square to Saturn saying, all right, Saturn, you have to build the kingdom and you have to get my emotional needs met. And Saturn doesn't get to take a break, but he really needs to. So it's definitely a time for people to just take a break and let things settle is usually the best strategy. And if the people who are pushing for something to happen, for trying to force something, saying, I need this now during this eclipse, they're the ones that are going to find their lives having more problems. The people can just say, okay, I'll just take a break. I'll just chill. I'll just relax. I'll go do any something else. They're going to wait. They're going to find things are sort of just going to work themselves out much better.
Well, there's a lot of fear associated sometimes when someone looks at their chart, there's an eclipse coming and, you know, various other things that are happening. There's a lot of fear. And sometimes I'll tell people, don't be so fearful, because sometimes that karma is hitting the bad guys, the criminals, like we saw the big news yesterday with Delphi, one of the biggest mysteries in the past 5 years. Bridge guy was finally caught, which may have been influenced by the eclipse.
Probably was, yeah.
And one thing that we focused on in a past show. And so it's not always the good people who are in a bad spot there with eclipses. Sometimes bad people maybe are taken out. Is that
I mean, eclipses give great things. I mean, and eclipses can take things away. They do both, but they're definitely periods of very important change. I don't consider anything that happens on the eclipse a bad thing. Sometimes some hard things happen, but like I said, it's a step along the road to where we need to go. I always look forward to eclipses. I'm like, okay, this is the time where new stuff can come in and life can change, sometimes more unexpectedly than ever. And yeah, sometimes the changes feel kind of shitty, but at least it's a change.
Exactly. You know, it's not boring.
Right? Right? I don't. And then sometimes it's like, wow, I never thought it would be like this, or that this could happen, and you're happy.
Yeah.
Exactly. You just got to see. It's always worthwhile.
I'm sure there were eclipses that were affecting me at the time when I started going through Sati. And that's when I really discovered your channel and your teachings. And then I don't know why, but I felt, well, I do know why, because I think I've got a progressed Saturn moon in my 10th. So I think I need to be talking about it a lot or something. But with Sati, you know, things, that energy just, it's brutal to some. And
it's rough, for sure.
Yeah. And that's why I tie it together a little bit with omens, because when I started really getting into astrology, it was, you know, I'm an observant person, and observant people will say, okay, what's going on? This is just weird. And what's all of this energy here? And why am I seeing all these omens? Now, I don't know if I'm more observant or not, or maybe I've always seen omens, but it seemed like I saw more during the Saturn moon transit. One, after a string of what you would call bad omens, I saw a feather in the yard. And my best friend, who she was in her 40s, died of cancer. And of course, you experience death from loved ones and friends during this time, among many other things. And it was like, I don't know, it just felt like a good omen. So, what are some of the things that you tell people with omens? Like, do people call you or text you like they do me and send you like video? Is this a good omen or a bad omen?
How I do it is, I do it really logically. I do the whole thing logically, and I'm just giving you started with the Saudi example, Saudi Zati. So I'm just going to give a funny example there. So when my Saudi Zati started, the day after it started, I was going on a trip with my family. Okay. I was packing my clothes, and I never wear black. This is blue. It's not black. Okay, I rarely wear black, but I had some black clothing because I'll go to a thrift store and just buy anything that fits. That's wool and whatever, you know. So I'm packing for this trip, and I throw some clothes down on the floor, and I go to get my duffel bag to throw them in, and I look. Every article of clothing I had taken out of the closet was black. The pants, the sweater, the t-shirt. I was like, oh wow, I never wear black, and somehow without thinking about it, I only pulled black. And I said, oh, my Saudi Sati's just started like this morning. And I was like, well, this is going to be something interesting on the trip, you know? And what happened in that trip is that going on that trip ended up with the loss of a very good friend. And black, of course, is no color. It represents loss, right? It represents emptiness and loss or void. And I thought that was like really so funny how I just pulled black. So how I use omens in general is first, I see astrology itself as an omen. If you think about it, an omen is anything that's happening around you and you read it. And the way I read omens, I go about it really logically. So it's not like I have a little book that says, look this omen up. It's just a matter of saying logically, how does this correlate? Just it's just a logical, it's an exercise in logic. And I kind of got this idea because in the old books, some of them they'll have books on omens, and they'll say things like in the chapters on, when a guy brings a girl's horoscope to ask about the marriage, because they have a lot of omens about that. And so they'll say things like, if someone comes and brings a horoscope of a girl to marry, and if somebody is sawing or digging close by, say no, the girl is not a virgin. It's like, so it's like these really, okay, I can kind of grasp the crude logic there, So there, and so I just started saying, okay, this is really just an exercise in logic. Someone's sticking a pole in something, it means something if someone asks that question, right? And so I just started logically analyzing the circumstances that are happening. And at the end of the day, everything is an omen.
I was going to ask
Everything
too.
is a symbol of what's happening within ourselves.
Okay. It's
Everything.
consciousness, right?
Well,
Consciousness. It's really the consciousness, but that's at a lower level.
it's just the simple beauty that everything in life is interconnected. And the omen that we don't expect, the thing we don't expect, that's the one to pay attention to. Because that's the one that's going to tell us the thing we're not clear on, that we're not paying attention, that we don't know. So if you see blue, say you see blue jays all the time, well, who cares? Don't read those that omen. But if
Oh,
you're
wow.
in a season
I just saw a blue jay.
where blue jays never show up, and all of a sudden there's a blue jay, that's unusual. So you always got to look for the out of season, the unusual thing,
Right.
not
I need
the
to
regular
know
thing.
what does a blue jay mean?
So all birds are messengers.
Okay.
Okay. And when you see an omen, you have to say, is it a good omen or a bad omen? If you see a blue jay that's been around, ran over, not a good thing. Okay. So a blue jay can be a messenger that somebody has a friend or an acquaintance or someone who has similar goals as you, something along those lines. So not a lover, you know, some other associate, has something that you need to know.
Oh,
Okay.
interesting. Okay.
Or if you get a bad blue jay omen, say somebody calls me and says, hey, I got this thing to tell you, and they tell you, and then all of a sudden, you know, you see a car hit a blue jay on its windshield, then
Okay.
you know that what they said is not valid, and you don't want to act on it. So again, is it a good omen or a bad omen?
It's interesting. Yeah, because my blue jay, and I haven't seen one in, I don't know, years, but there was a fountain that I was sitting next to, and he just kind of hopped in there and started drinking. So I was like, okay, what
Okay,
does
that's nice. So that means there's an associate, you know, someone who's, you know, working towards the same goals as you, or perhaps a friend who has something nourishing for you, right?
Oh, I like it.
Water, right? So
I
that,
love
you
it.
know, so you have to see if that when that person pops in.
And I didn't want to cut you off. You were talking about how astrology is an omen in itself, but I think
I
you
mean,
had.
everything's an omen. Astrology is a huge omen because we got these big planets, right? These big things floating around and hitting us. And, you know, it's just the way omens work, it's because of the interconnectedness of everything. So that includes the planets. And it's really nature is talking to us all the time through the
Exactly.
omens.
I
Animal omens are really powerful.
have.
Anything is powerful, you know. And let's say I had a gosh, I don't remember the details of that one, sorry, but I don't remember what the result was. But a couple of weeks ago, I had this owl just jumping all over my ceiling, and I have a glass roof in my room,
Okay.
so you can imagine the owl's jumping on the roof, how much noise that's making, right?
Okay.
It's not like I have a roof with 4 inches of insulation and I can't hear. It's like kachink, it's like claws, like this, you know.
I don't like
For
this.
20 minutes. And so I finally go out and I find well, he finally I can hear where he's going on my roof, the place where I can see. So I go out there and I look at him and I can see him really good. And finally he sees me and freaks out and goes away. And owl is the knower of secrets.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm like thinking, okay, there's some secret that I'm here to that I'm going to be discovering, you know, and that's what happened within a couple of days. The next day it was anyway interesting day from that omen. This owl literally woke me up at like 2 a.m. and I stayed up most of the night because I couldn't get back to sleep. So,
That's
so I
amazing.
considered that like a good omen. He needed to tell me some stuff. So animal omens have been really amazing. Recently, I was, you know. Just driving down the road, and in a place where it wasn't normal, there's a vulture just standing on the side of the road.
Oh.
And right at that time, I had some concerns for somebody. And then I was thinking, I was going to have some concern for someone I was thinking about. You know, an hour later, when I stopped driving, I checked my messages, and that person's having a rough time of things. Okay, sort of melting down, actually. And I when I saw that I said, oh, they're having trouble. That's, you know, vultures are like things are dying, something's dying, something's deteriorating. And so, you know, animals, there's a lot of good books on animals for people to get who want to learn omens. I like the medicine cards. It's a good starter book
Okay.
to learn about animal omens. There's other books out there, but I think they try to sometimes say too much and it gets lost in the woods. So I really like the medicine cards book is a really great animal omen book to start with. But it's animal omens have been fantastic.
That's great. Yeah. I have a friend and partner on here, Grace Wilson, and we're always looking for new books. So that's a good recommendation. And the next question I have for you and everyone, if you have questions for Ernst, please write any. I think actually let me go to Lana here. She says, I was waiting in my kids' line on Tuesday. I guess this was at school, and this random kid shirt said, "Everything will be okay." I registered it, and that night I woke up and my thoughts went to that phrase. I took it as an omen. Well, that's a positive sign, yeah. I guess.
And also with omens, the very important thing is to be conscious of what you're thinking about as you see the omen.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking about somebody and I saw that vulture. You know, me seeing that vulture didn't mean I was going to have, I was going to have a problem down the road or anything like that. Okay. And so you always got to pay attention to your thoughts. That's the most important thing in analyzing any omen.
I love people who are, senior citizens or seniors. I worked with them. I have friends, but I got to say, and I don't know if I should say this, but I went to go for a Powerball ticket. And it wasn't necessarily the lady who came up, and she was very old, came up in front of me. It was just that the cashier was just taking a long time. And I was just going to go in and get some quick numbers. And it was just a really long wait. And then I decided to bail on the numbers because I thought, well, maybe that's Saturn. That's that's somehow influencing me as I get these numbers. So I decided not to do it. But I don't know. Saturn sometimes will stop things, I think.
Yeah, I think that's sort of good because you're getting Saturn influence. You said there was an elderly person there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And she came up like just out of the blue. Like I was the next one in line and somehow, she was the next one and I didn't even see her. She just sort of appeared. And yeah,
so that's definitely a Saturn, I think, saying no, because when you have a Saturn omen, elderly people are Saturn, you don't do something that's going to start your life.
Exactly.
You want to go there and win $1 million, just have your whole new life. You're going to start this and start this, and there's an old person,
yes,
right? That's
you want to be around, I don't know, babies.
Yeah, you wanted was somebody to fall over and give birth, you know. Oh no, I'm having
exactly.
My baby now, you know?
Some kind of beginning. Lana has one. I had the one about vultures, a true story. A few weeks back there was a foggy morning. I drove my kids to school, and after the store trip I took a shortcut home. It was a small road behind the store. And I guess, so you saw a vulture, Lana. Oh, there was, okay, here she is.
Okay, where's that?
There was a trash pile with 5+ vultures on top of it and said it scared her to death. Here's something that, just to follow that, a girlfriend of mine was terrified of a big white bird, and it looked like a nice bird. It was like a big white, I don't know what it was, but then it flew away from her. So it seems to me that when you're looking at omens like Lana's, you're looking at the behavior. It's not just that animal omen.
Yeah, the behavior and also the amount of animals that you see. Because numbers are a very obvious omen. Not anytime things come up in numbers.
Okay, Lana, how long ago was that? And also let us know if you thought that was an omen for something in your life. But vultures, yeah, I guess that would disturb me.
Vultures are the vehicle of Saturn, actually. So in Hindu mythology, Saturn rides a vulture. And they're birds of death. And, they symbolize death, obviously. So, when you see a vulture, that means death. On some level, but we have to take death in the really broad meaning, in the context of it's our ego that's constantly undergoing different states of death.
Exactly.
We're constantly going through transformations and our ego's dying.
Yeah. And Lana was saying it was about 2 weeks ago. I remember, when I was going to church, I saw it was like 100 vultures on top of the roof. And it was a few months into when COVID started. And so I was nervous about that. I was like, oh God, this is more than one person. So yeah, I guess the black bird tends to scare a lot of people.
Yeah.
CK just wrote in, I saw a dead squirrel. What's the omen for that? I guess anything dead is probably not good.
Usually dead things are not great, you
No.
bet. So squirrels are gatherers. They're about, okay, you're preparing for your future, or you're pulling together things you need to get you through the next stage of your life. And when you see a dead one, it means you're not, and that, or maybe you think you are, but the dead squirrel is there to tell you, that's not going to work. Because really, it's about restoring your resources, is what squirrel is all about.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Abba says, is there a traditional meaning for a tortoise or turtle? I feel like
Well,
we should know, but is there? What do you?
yeah, well, the turtle, tortoise or turtle represents Mother Earth. So it's the foundation everything lies upon. So seeing a turtle can mean there's something, in your foundation's in question. There's something you have to add to your foundation, perhaps, or something you will add to your foundation. But interesting enough, turtle is also related to Saturn. It's funny, everyone's pulling up these Saturn omens,
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, so there's a quality of rabbits as well have a Saturn quality to them. Okay.
This is interesting. I'm glad Gina brought this up. I want to research this further. I live in the country and have tons of animals everywhere: deer, owl,
Yeah.
coyotes, bald eagles, and you're in the same
All in
situation.
the same place, yeah.
Yeah,
Yeah, so
so
she used to get that medicine cards. It's a deck with a book. The
okay.
book is really great. It has a card deck, so you can do card readings based on those omens.
Okay.
But it's a great book. She'll have a lot of fun with it.
Okay, great. I'm going to get
So,
that too.
does Lana know what happened? I mean, does she kind of put that connect that omen to some events that happened afterwards?
It was 2 weeks ago, so it seems like it might be too early yet. So, I'm not
Yeah,
sure.
so vultures can be about, death of the ego, death of something that you're attached to, death of something someone else is attached to. So if you're thinking about someone else, it's something in their life that they're attached to that's being broken. But they always are about the need of letting go of some aspect of ourselves or something in our lives.
Okay, here's a
Yeah.
good one. When you see animals on ads, is that part of an omen as well? For example, on Facebook or websites, like if you just see
I mean,
pictures.
I guess you could say so. I mean, everything's an omen for sure. And I think the computer can sometimes deliver up that little omen for you. If it's in an unusual place, I mean, if you spent the last week searching for wildlife pictures and now there's wildlife and they're trying to sell you some wildlife stuff on your sidebar, I wouldn't really pay a lot of attention to it. Okay.
Okay.
But if it just kind of is in a weird place and it sticks out as unusual, then you could pay attention to it. So it's
Grace,
really,
I was going to say, yeah, butterflies.
So Grace is asking about butterflies. Butterflies are, transformation, of course, because the butterfly is gone from the worm to the beautiful butterfly, the gross little worm to the beautiful butterfly. So they're simply omens of transforming to a better state of being in some area of our lives. And
Okay.
one of the beautiful things about omens, especially the animal omens, is it merely makes you see how interconnected we are with nature and how nature is actually serving us. I mean, think about it. Say you're going around your life like an idiot and you've got a dead turtle omen, right? Then this turtle is like kind of giving its life for you to tell you that, And that's pretty profound if you think about it. It's like,
Oh, wow.
I mean, we're really, and especially if you have pets, if you have a pet and your pet dies, that's a huge omen of something in your life. If it's unnatural, of course, if they die of old age, but if something odd happens, it's something to think about. The stuff our pets are going through, say you get an animal that gets cancer, that's an omen on your life. And so you need to study that and think about
And that kind of goes into remedies too, a little bit, where They say with some transits, you should care for a sick dog, or you try to turn around.
Yeah, you can take care of things, give charity. Yeah. Charity is really the best kind of remedial to do.
Lana is saying she's.
Okay. So
It
she,
sounds like, Lana, you're going through study.
yeah. So she says here, I have had the worst 2 weeks and even worse of the year. My parents are elderly, overseas. My marriage died. I'm changing my career. So basically, everything is breaking down, dying. She saw a bunch of vultures on a pile of trash. So the key word here is they're on a pile of trash. So that means all these things that are leaving out of her life are maybe a little too trashy for her and they need to go, you know?
Ah, yeah,
It's
she's
unusual
taking out the
signal.
trash.
On a, yeah, so I think the vultures are kind of getting rid of some things and it'll be a good start over for you, Lana.
And not to say that about, of course, family, but I mean, just bad things are maybe they're going to be at a distance at some point, and you just
Yeah.
feel like you're in the thick of it. And I'm so glad I could bring Ernst on, because when I was in that part of my life, that's when I started watching Ernst's programs and really started to understand. It makes you feel better that other people are going through this, and then understanding that
Yeah.
the US. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sure that eclipse really tagged her.
Oh, yeah.
Because that eclipse is also a big relationship maker or breaker. Yeah. And so, the fact that she saw these vultures had been saying, hey, there's a lot of things that you need to let go of now. There's some death coming, which means parts of her she needs to let go of herself and shift out of. And it'll be a healthy transformation because none of the vultures were dead. They were just doing their thing and telling her you got huge, deep changes to go and your ego's gonna, yeah, die, which is never any fun, but it's gonna be part she doesn't really need anymore. It'll be a good transition for her. It might take some time, obviously. It's a lot going on, but I think it's gonna be really positive.
Before, there's a couple that I wanted to talk about, but I gotta say, I had a friend who was she had a home office, and she had there was like this construction outside, and somebody was operating a jackhammer. And I just had happened to see your show on Omens or something, and talked about what that means, and you were 100% spot on. And that would reflect the relationship she had with her significant other, which was he just wanted her for her body.
Yeah, he
I
doesn't want to
believe
have
that's what it was.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds funny, but it's not when you're actually experiencing that and trying to, make a life for yourself and settle
Yeah.
down with the right person.
And that's just like I said in the old books in India, the guy comes and he says, should I marry this girl? And then if somebody starts sawing or digging, you say, no, don't marry her. That's like a bad omen. And the same thing happened here. I think in that other show, how I said it, if somebody comes and says, does he love me? All of a sudden, someone fires up a jackhammer. You say he loves having sex with you. And that's about it.
Thankfully, we don't hear about that too often.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's a pretty funny omen that you had see happen. I've
That
never
one.
let Patrick do use that one on anyone. No jackhammers around here.
Okay, this is a good one. Interesting. What about an omen of a rainbow? And that makes me think of the queen, how there was that double rainbow after she died. And there have been a lot of reports in my family and friend circles that there was a rainbow after, something happened that was major in their lives. What do you say about that?
Okay, so a rainbow, first of all, to interpret anything, you always want to pay attention. What am I thinking of? So if you're thinking about something, you come around the corner and there's a rainbow, or you're thinking about something, all of a sudden the rainbow pops out. You have to take the rainbow in the context of what you were ruminating over. Okay, so it's not like a rainbow is going to mean a certain thing. It depends on your mindset, what you're thinking about. But a rainbow is the beautiful thing that comes after a period of trouble. Okay, the rainbow is called the Indradhanus, which is the bow of Indra. And Indra is the god of thunder. He's basically like Thor. Okay, and he goes up there, and the big black evil demon is in the sky, darkening the sky, giant rain cloud, right? then, Indra, who's basically Thor in India, goes up there, uses his lightning to destroy that evil demon. The rain comes down, waters things. That lets us know now food's going to grow, everyone's going to be able to eat. And then the sky clears, the rainbow comes out when the sky is clearing, right? There's mist in the air, but there's still sunlight. And that's showing that, all right, that was scary. There's this big gloomy demon in the sky, but now it's all going to work out good, or it's going
Wow.
to lead to beautiful things. So it shows the period of trouble has ended. So if you're thinking, oh, my boyfriend guy, he's been such a, so horrible the last 6 months and a rainbow pops up, it's like, yeah, he's been a dick, but things are going to get better now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. Well, hopefully the Queen's omen was good for King Charles. But that's a whole other
And
discussion.
rainbows are almost always double rainbows. Just the second one is usually much more diminished, and you don't always notice it. But sometimes you'll be lucky and you'll see two very distinctly colored ones if you're in a really good place.
Okay. As far as the history of omens, and if you were to look far back in the annals of time, what would you think of, and what would you attribute some of the famous or historic omens to? Like, it was a long time ago.
Yeah, forever, really. I think that all primitive people relied heavily on omens. I mean, you have to think about how their lives were compared to ours. Here we are, we're constantly getting stimulated by all this nonsense, reading this book, watching this video, watching this TV show, talking to this person. We're constantly getting inundated with stuff, Imagine if all that stuff wasn't there. Then what would you do? You'd basically be paying attention to what's happening.
Exactly.
You'd be attention, everything that's happening in your neighborhood, in your forest, whatever. And you would start connecting the dots. Wow, I was thinking this, and a vulture killed, I saw a vulture carry a dead rabbit away. Huh,
Yeah,
And
exactly.
so, and I think they just started noticing it because it's really so obvious. If you had time to actually think about what your surroundings mean to you, it's not very difficult. It's just we don't have the luxury of that time because we're not bored enough. We're totally inundated with nonsense, basically.
Well, I'm
Including
always,
this video, of course.
what's
I'm
that?
including
Right.
this video.
Well, I'm always fascinated with the comets and all of that. Have you given any thought to
Yeah,
those?
there's comets are very, very important. There's a great book called Brihat-samhita. It's not an easy book. It's a Sanskrit translated into English, two giant volumes by Varaha Mihira. And that book is mostly about omens. It has some astrology, and he's a famous astrologer from the 6th century India. And when he talks about you look at a person's sore before they go on the battlefield, and you can tell what's going to happen to them on the battlefield the next time they go out.
Okay.
So in just all kinds of omens. They also have a chapter on comets and what different comets portend. And there's a lot to it. Some comets are bringing in good energy, some are bringing bad energy in. But they're very, very important. And you'll see some amazing people die, amazing people are born on comets.
Yes.
Like the most famous example of that, of course, was Mark Twain. He was born on Halley's Comet, and he said, "I think when Halley's comes back around, I'll die."
I remember that
He
one.
left on Halley's Comet. Princess Diana, Mother Teresa, died in that with that comet that was discovered back in 96, 97. I don't remember the name of that comet. It was a beautiful comet up there for 2 months.
Okay.
All summer long. So that they took off on that comet. So if
I
they
think
do,
Grace knows that one. Grace, which one was that again? I can't remember. But yeah, I
yeah.
think you were talking
But
about it the
comets
other
are important. You have to analyze them, what color they are, what's their tail like. One of the problems these days is that they're discovering comets all the time now, but most of these are not visible to the naked eye.
day.
And usually the ones that are visible to the naked eye that you look up and go, oh, wow, those are the ones you really have to watch out for. But
Okay.
they could be world-changing comets. When you see comets that are visible, there's going to be important events changing in the world. Somehow, I mean, Princess Diana dying impacted a lot of people. You know, it was a huge impact upon people and how, it created a huge inner shift in a lot of people. So, yeah, it's really interesting.
Grace is asking about a red moon. Any thoughts about that?
Yeah, I don't usually pay attention to those. Not that it's not correct or I shouldn't. The reason is I'm a little prejudiced because with all the pollution going on, I don't want to add pollution to my omenology. I probably should, but pollution changes the light of things dramatically, of course.
Yes, that's true.
If I just wanted to analyze a red moon, okay, well, moon obviously is your consciousness. It's what you're feeling, it's what you're taking in. Red is the fire color. It can represent anger, over excessiveness, your blood's pumping, extra lust, extra passion, anything where there's extra fire in your system.
Maybe passion, Grace.
Yeah, so it could mean that there's just a lot of emotional fire going on about something. And that I would take that as a cautious omen. In fact, in Brihat Samhita, they do warn against the red moon because if you're overly fired up about something, you're probably get a jump to something that's not quite right. It means you're coming from an overly emotional place. We're not supposed to act on our emotions. Emotions are not for acting on, and people who act on their emotions find they get into a lot of trouble. And that means you're acting on your emotions and you're going to get into trouble, is what a red moon would be. Our emotions are for communicating important things to us. So we need us to tell, we need to pay attention to emotions to see what are my emotions telling me. So let's say you haven't heard from someone for a while, and then you're going to meet them, and then when you get there, they're not there. Well, then you analyze your emotions. If you're disappointed, that doesn't mean you're supposed to act out of that disappointment. That disappointment just tells you, actually, you really did want to see that person. Real simple. It's like, what are our emotions telling us? Because they are here to communicate important things about ourselves. They're not here to act on. And once we recognize those important things our emotions telling us, then we have the clarity on how we need to act.
Absolutely. And just as an aside, Grace reminded me, Haley Bopp, I think you were talking
Yeah,
about.
that's what it is, Haley. But I was going to say bebop, but I know it's not bebop.
Okay, bats is a good one, especially for this Halloween. That can't be good, seeing a bat.
No, bats. All animal omens are good unless the animal by attacks you or is dead. So dead animals and animals attacking you, things like that, biting you, are not good. But otherwise, they're good. Okay.
Abba was saying something about her neighbor's tortoise making it through to her backyard twice at the beginning of this month. And I keep seeing them in seeing randomly. This whole month I've been focusing on my foundation and routine.
Perfect. Yeah.
That
So,
sounds like quite a message at this dirt. I would name him. Doesn't sound threatening to me though.
No. It's hard to find a threatening turtle omen, they don't regularly bite you unless you have a snapping turtle. But usually a bad t or toad sorry, bad turtle omen is when you see a dead one or something.
Okay. Grace
Yeah.
just said fat chance on the passion of the moon, but you never know. You never know. I say a red moon is an angry moon.
Yeah,
It
I can be
just
angry too. Just your it means you're going, you have too much emotions about something. Yeah, and you don't want to act on those emotions. And you probably are gonna you are probably are acting on something emotionally.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, can I just quickly switch over for a second?
Yeah.
And you know what this channel does. We look at the crime charts or the time that somebody commits a crime. And there's different
Yeah.
feelings by different astrologers about that. I know there's a very big astrologer who does not like to touch the subject. But we moons and Scorpios and Saturn in the eighth houses, We gotta dig in. So what do you say about
I think it's a really great use of astrology, try to figure out who did it. In fact, all the old astrology books, one of the biggest topics in those old astrology books is who did it. So it's something that's been done forever with astrology. And they actually say that prajna, or what they call horary astrology, casting a chart for the moment of the question or the moment of an event and coming up with the answer from that, is older than birth chart reading. And they've developed these systems to really high levels. I mean, there's parts of India where they don't even bother with your birth time and your birthday. Just from when you show up for the reading, they'll predict when you're going to die.
That's amazing. Yeah.
And they also, they have all kinds in these books, they have all kinds of instructions of how to figure out the thief, how to see where the missing person is, how to see if the missing person's going to come back. So this is an authentic, traditional use of astrology, a huge use. And the chapters on, things getting stolen and missing people, that kind of stuff are bigger than most of the chapters in these books. So it's a big part of the subject matter. So it's definitely a traditional and authentic use of astrology, and I think a really great use of it.
That's great. Well, we're all glad you think so. And if you ever want to help us with a crime, well, you know where to find us. Okay. Sounds like you're pretty busy though, and
I point you towards some, I don't know, are you using like Western horary techniques for that?
Yes, we use the Western horary, and we'll use the degree theory. So degrees mean different things, but there have been some questions from Vedic astrologers who they really would like to focus more on that. And that's a project that I would like to take on.
At some point. Definitely. It's good to have some people working on that. Yeah, that's real fascinating that you are involved in that. It's a rare thing that people get involved in whodunits with astrology, but it's a great use of it.
Well, I think that the sheer discipline, and you can apply this to a lot of different astrology disciplines, but I feel like you start to understand death. Of course, my main understanding of death came after Sati, where I didn't fear it anymore. But with forensic astrology, you start to understand that people are destined, and maybe, and this might be a bad thing to say, but maybe there's a little percentage of feeling empathetic towards someone who is on this earth and they're destined to become someone very evil or do an evil act. What do you say about that?
Yeah, I mean, definitely there is a destiny factor there. So that's the thing. When we start looking at the bigger picture, we realize the whole machine has to sort of work together,
The yin and yang, I guess.
Like this whole creation. Say I have the karma, the destiny to get $1 million, right? That means somebody or some people have the karma destiny to not have $1 million. So let's say it's my destiny to have $1 million, and I'm going to do it by teaching astrology, okay? That means there's some astrologers out there who have the destiny to lose $1 million when they try to teach astrology, right?
Exactly.
Or maybe I'm losing my million to them. I don't know. But, so it's like the same thing. If somebody has the destiny to be a victim, there has to be somebody who has the destiny to be a murderer.
Exactly.
The murderer just shows up and takes a person. A human being can't create someone's destiny.
Mm-hmm.
A serial killer can't create someone's destiny of being a victim.
Right.
And that's the sad reality. It's a really crazy movie when you start thinking of it that way.
It is. It's I compare it to people being born and being put onto like a roller coaster. And there are different types of roller coasters. There's the one that everybody sees in the distance, and you can see people going up and down in their lives. And then there are the other roller coasters that might be deep and dark and evil. And then there's another one that might where you do great things, but nobody sees. And you're just kind of there along for the ride. And with forensic astrology, though, you do a lot of I guess consulting with victims of crime, and they don't understand. I think they understand a little bit more that, like, just recently, someone, a mom of a young boy who died, said, "I thought he was going to be president. My oldest daughter is asking why he's gone, and what was the purpose of his life?" she asks, and so she has to answer that to her kids, and it's very difficult, but she's using astrology to start understanding that, you know, his death, there was a reason for his death. It's going to be a force of change. It's going to change things and put things in motion. And so you know, that's all you can say, I guess, but
See, when we talk about this, we're getting to a big philosophical world, and so that's always a dangerous ground. But
exactly.
how I see it is that when somebody dies, honestly, they're sort of the lucky ones. You know, I mourn the people they leave behind. I'm
Yes.
like, you're out of here, you passed, you graduated, dude.
Exactly.
You left all these people down here, and they have to suffer now even worse without your help. That's really how I see it when people die. You know, I mean, I feel sorry for the rest of us stuck down here.
I
It's not like this is paradise. This is a hard place of hard learning and
It is,
constant testing. And those of us who are into astrology have usually had a little more of our fair share of that. And that's why we grab onto this lifeline, right?
yeah. Exactly.
And
Yeah.
so I think that when people die young, or they die tragic deaths, or they die unexpectedly, I don't really see that as a tragedy. How I see that is, okay, that's they only needed that much experiences on this earth at this time, where it's still a really kind of not a great place to be. And you know, and they got to get out in 20 years, and I'm still here. When you know,
Exactly.
it's
That's
like
so.
I don't consider it a tragedy for them.
That's
They get to move on, and they get to evolve, and I really feel like we're all here with an arrangement of events that's not here for our happiness, not here for anyone else's happiness even. It's really to get us to evolve and grow as far fast as we can in those years that we're here. And there's a point where there's nothing on this earth that's necessary for us to grow, and we leave. How they say it with astrology in the old books, of course, they talk about when the karma for the physical body is burnt out, you die. Because there's just no karma left, and you can't incarnate without karma. You can't get a body, they say. But again, we're dealing with philosophical things, and you can't
It's a good
tell
way to
people
put it, but
philosophy.
yeah, and our audience appreciates your point of view on that. And we have just a minute left, and I wanted to ask you, is there anything that's coming up? You're just nose to the grindstone right now, so you're doing your next project. Anything you can say about your next project?
Well, what I'm working on some older zodiac symbology, like we're talking pre-Greek, because most of the symbology we have is Greek, Persian. I'm talking about older symbology of the zodiac going back with completely different symbols, going back, you know, centuries before Greek and Persian.
Wow. Oh, that sounds exciting.
It'll be a lot of fun. I hope to start teaching that early next year.
Well, we love symbols, and I'm going to put your information in the description box. And thank you so much for your time. We really
My pleasure.
appreciate it. And we'll look for you in the coming months then.
Okay, thank you. Good to meet you.
All right, you too. Bye, everybody.